I'm going to the next level, and my next level is called greater. My brothers and sisters, as leaders in God's church, as people of God who attend the local assembly of the church, this phrase, next level, is a phrase that we often hear. For there have been many conferences that have been structured around the point of teaching the church to leave the past in the past and to embrace a higher dimension in God. My brothers and sisters, this catchphrase, this coin phrase of the next level is a phrase that we often hear mentioned in the house of God, that we should have a desire to go to the next level. And if that was not good enough, they left that phrase, going to the next level, and they added a word to it that says that we should go to the next dimension. In other words, they both speak of going to a place that seemingly is out of our reach, but it is a possibility. Let me say that again. The next level is a place that seemingly is out of our reach, but it is a possibility. And if, in fact, you are serving the true and living God, you should never become stagnated or satisfied with where you are. Let me say that again. If you are serving the true and the living God, you should never become satisfied or complacent or stagnated with where you are. The reason being is because certainly we serve a God of movement. Tell your neighbor, movement. We serve a God that is always moving. He is always progressing. He is always active. He is always forward in his position. We serve a God who is always moving and who is always active, who is always forward in position. And if, in fact, we serve a God who is always moving forward, who is always active, who is always progressing, how can we, as the people of God, not look like the Father we're serving? Y'all ain't helping me yet. We serve a God who is always active, who is always progressing, who is always moving forward. So if, in fact, we are the children of the Most High God, we always should be on the move. Tell your neighbor, you got to get on the move. And the problem with the body of Christ now, my brothers and sisters, we have become to the place in our walk with God where we have become satisfied with small accomplishments when God is saying, I desire so much more from you. We have become complacent with what we did yesterday, what we did last week, what we did last month, what we did last year. But God is saying, I've got so much more that I want you to do, and I desire that you go to the next level. Tell your neighbor, I can't stay here. He has a desire for me to go to the next level. He has a desire for me to move. And if, in fact, we are serving a God who is moving, it doesn't take you long to understand that God is a God of movement. All you have to do is go to the first page of the Bible. For in Genesis 1:1, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created. Watch this. In the beginning, God was moving. In the end, God will still be moving. And if we are serving a moving God, it is time that we come out of complacency and stagnation. It is time that we go to the next level. Tell your neighbor, I've got to go to the next level. And that's the message that is found in our text for our consideration. For it is in now this gospel of Luke. Luke now, who was a physician. Luke now, who goes on record to record this gospel. It was in the 4th chapter of Luke we find Jesus now was tempted by the devil 3 times. And as he was tempted, every time he was tempted, he responded by letting Satan know, it is written in the word of God. Let me help somebody here. In this season, you don't need to cuss. You don't need to fight. You don't need to get stressed out. You don't need to suffer from worryation. You don't need to suffer from depression. But in this season, the only thing you need to do is let sin, Satan, and society know it is written in the word of God. Tell your neighbor, it's already in the book. What's in the book? It's in the book that you are the head and not the tail. It's in the book that you are the lender and not the borrower. It's in the book that you are above and not beneath. It is in the book that by his stripes you are already healed. It is in the book that, and we know that all things work together for the good of them that love the Lord. It's in the book.
been formed against you shall prosper. It is in the book that weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Tell your neighbor, it is in the book. And that's why I'm not going to be moved by what I see. I'm not going to be moved by what I feel. I'm not going to be moved by what I hear, but I'm going to be moved by what I believe. Ask your neighbor a question, what do you believe? I know you shout about it, but do you believe it? I know you come to church every Sunday, but do you believe in the word of God? Look at your neighbor and say, I believe the word. And I don't care who comes and who goes. I don't care how much time people look at you funny. I'm learning how to stand on the word of God. Is there anybody here that can testify that there's power in the word of God? When everything else is failing and everything else is falling, I've learned how to depend on the word of God. Can you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, can you depend on the word of God? When you don't know how you're going to make it out, can you depend on his words? David said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against God. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, there's power in the word of God. Y'all be seated, please. The Bible says now that after he was tempted by the devil, he makes his way now and he sees his disciples in Luke chapter 5. The Bible says that after he was tempted, tell your neighbor, don't miss this. After he was tempted, the Bible says he went into the synagogue as it was his custom. The Bible says he went from being tempted to going into the synagogue. If Jesus had to go to church, y'all ain't coming to hear. If Jesus had to go to church, the Bible said he left being tempted. He went to the synagogue as was his custom. If Jesus had to go to church, who do you think you are? That you ain't got to go to the house of God. Now, I don't need to go down there. You know the church ain't right, and neither are you. Hello, somebody. Bible says he went to the temple, the synagogue, as his custom. And the priest was reading out of the scroll, and Jesus told him, he said, this day, somebody say this day, is the scripture fulfilled. He said, what you've been looking for, you are now looking at. He said, the spirit of the Lord is upon me. Tell your neighbor, the spirit is all on me. The Bible says he left there and he was encountered by these fishermen. And when I look at this text, these fishermen, the Bible says that when Jesus saw them, they were washing their nets. Let me say that again. They were washing their nets. Washing their nets was a sign of finality. It was a sign that they had given up. It was a sign that all hope was gone. Jesus saw these men washing their nets. They had been out all night long fishing, had not caught anything. And they said, you know what? I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. Anybody ever got to that place in your life where it seemed like you've been doing it a long time and seemingly things are not coming together? But watch what Jesus does. Jesus saw them and he tells them to launch out into the deep. You go into the next level of greater. First of all, you've got to learn how to ignore past failures. So many times we get caught up because something did not work the way we thought it was going to work. But baby, in this season, I'm not concerned about what happened yesterday. I'm not concerned about what happened last week just because it did not work then. If God tells me to do it one more time, I'm going to have faith to trust him when I cannot trace him. Look at your neighbor and say, ignore past failures. Ignore past failures. And he tells him, what you need to do is launch out into the deep. Some of us, we hang around too many shallow-minded people. Y'all give me 5 minutes. We hang around people that don't want to leave their comfort zone. As long as you are in a shallow place, you are in control. Because you're in a shallow area. But when you launch out into the deep, you are at a place now where the control is no longer. longer in your hands. Yeah. Jesus tells you, launch out into the deep, and I want you to prepare for a draught. Somebody say draught. Draught means a big catch.
Right.
Draught means a big catch. Let me somatically submit to you that what God is about to do in this next season of your life, it is not going to be something small, but God is going to do something big. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm getting ready for it. I'm getting ready for something big. He tells them to launch out. Watch this. First of all, you have to ignore past failure. But secondly, you have to initiate the possibility of a future. Listen, just because it didn't work, that doesn't mean you can't start over again. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I've got to start over again. They had to listen to the Lord. The Lord said, Jesus said, listen, what I want you to do, I know you've given up. I know you've been out there all night, but I want you to try it again. Now look at these brothers, these fishermen. They were expert fishermen. Jesus was a carpenter.
All right.
And here it is, a carpenter is now telling me that I need to launch out into the deep. Wait a minute, Jesus, you're a carpenter, we're fishermen. We know how to do this. But Jesus said, listen, I want you to launch out into the deep. In this season of going to the next level, you got to learn how to be obedient to the word of God. Obedience is better than sacrifice. See, we got a lot of people in the house of God, they don't like to be obedient. Y'all ain't helping me. They like to do everything, but they don't want to be obedient. They don't want to listen to nobody. Can anybody know what I'm talking about? Can nobody tell them that? Tell somebody. They think they know everything. But then they call the pastor. Pastor, I need prayer. Pastor, I'm going through. Pastor, I'm sick. Pastor, I'm in trouble. But if you would have just been obedient.
All right.
Y'all ain't helping me. If you would have just been obedient and did what I told you to do, you wouldn't be in that problem. Right. Pastor, I don't understand why I'm struggling. You paying your tithe?
Yes,
sir.
Come on, come on.
See, we done mastered how to shout.
Yes, sir.
Oh, we done mastered how to do the hokey pokey and turn ourselves around. We know how to do that.
All right.
But have you mastered being obedient to the word of God? If you don't pay your tithes, you are cursed with a curse.
Come on.
Hello, somebody. So how do you expect God to bless you when you have been cursed?
Yes. Ain't no good.
Well, Pastor, we under the New Testament, we don't have to do this. Well, just keep on living the way you're living and see how far you go.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Amen. Jesus tells these men, he said, listen, I want you to launch out into the deep. And watch what Simon Peter the boy said. He said, Master, nevertheless, at your word. Somebody say the power is in the word. They said, nevertheless, we done told all night, but if you tell me to do it, nevertheless, and your word, I'm going to launch out into the deep. First of all, you got to understand, you got to ignore past failure. Secondly, you got to initiate the possibility of the future. But thirdly, you got to ignite your faith.
Yeah.
Tell your neighbor, you got to ignite your faith. The Bible says, they said, you know, Jesus, if you tell me to do it, I know I've been out there a long time, but if you tell me to go, I gotta go. If you tell me to do it, I'm gonna do it. In other words, they had faith in the word of God. Let me ask you a question. Where would you be if you just learned how to have faith in God? How far could you go if you learned how to have faith in God? For the Bible says that if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, you can speak to the mountain and tell the mountains to move out of your life. The Bible says without faith, it is impossible to please God. Can you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, all you need to do is have a little bit of faith. And in this season, if we just got enough faith to trust God through all the pain, to trust God through our disappointments, to trust God through our failures, to trust God through our shortcomings. The Bible said when they obey God, touch your neighbor, say obey God. A lot of us have mastered how to obey man, but we've got to learn how to master to obey God. The Bible says when they stepped out on faith, the Bible says they put the nets in the water. And the Bible says the nets were filled with so much fish that their nets begin to break. And I'm here to encourage somebody here today. I don't know what you're going through, and I don't know what you've been faced with. I don't know the problems that you're dealing with, but if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, in this next season, God is going to give you more than enough. Is there anybody here that can testify?